This is a fiddle, one of the most widely recognized instruments used in Celtic or Gaelic music. It has followed the Celts all over Europe and across the sea when the Irish came to the US and the Scottish came to Canada and Ireland and shared their music with the locals or other cultures. It has, Celtic music has developed into what we now know as old time or bluegrass in the States, Western swing, which was highly influenced by the jazz as well. And French Canadian music that goes as far as Métis music, when the fiddle music met music of the indigenous peoples, First Nations in the area, when the fur traders were around. Though not as old as the bagpipes in terms of instruments, and certainly not as old as whistles and or horns, it has become an extremely versatile instrument. A fiddle is also a violin. The instrument is the same. There's no difference at all, except for in the way it's played or the way it's set up. All my fiddles are set up to play folk music, which is considered fiddle music, versus classical and or jazz, which would be considered violin. Here, this is the bridge of the violin, and I'll come back to it later, this will be important, but the bridge connects to a sound post right inside the violin. If you can see, it's like right, the light, you can see that little post in there. These two pieces are the most important pieces of the violin for sound production. And if they're not placed properly, you won't get the sound you want. However, fiddlers tend to choose to position the sound post really close to the top string in order to get a very clanging, twangy sound that you might hear in Western or old time or bluegrass music. Northern Scottish fiddlers and fiddlers from the east coast of Ireland, Galway, County Clare, and stuff, tend to prefer their sound post placed here, near the low end of the fiddle. This produces a much darker tone. My fiddle is very set at a dark tone, because I prefer that. I mainly play Celtic music and Northern European music. With the bridge also, classical violins tend to have a very even distribution across the wood, and the feet set right in the center of the upholds, in between the two little notches right here. Fiddlers who prefer a dark sound also position the bridge in that same place. But as you can see online, people tend to carve their bridges down differently. I have my high strings set at the bottom in order to use a technique for jumping. Across the strings more easily. As well, it differs in the way a fiddle and violin is held. The classical players who seek more diversity of movement and to perfect their technique and kind of play in a uniform fashion for how the bows are moving the same, and all the tones come out the same other than the differences based on the individual violin. I will show you, not in great detail, but basically a classical fiddle is held this chin rest. Let me just find, I have another chin rest here, right here. I'm just going to have to move my cross here up because it's going to create some crickets, as we call, which is unwanted vibrations. They also tend to hold their wrist out in a very curved fashion so that they can get maximum length for the fingers. This has some difficulties and problems along with it, in that a lot of classical violinists who play professionally and practice many hours a day tend to develop problems with their neck and their wrist. They often get carpal tunnel and arthritis. I know fiddlers who can play for 10 hours a day and have done so for 70 years and don't get any of these problems. And I will argue that the violin was meant to be played the way a fiddler plays it. The way the fiddle is held and the way it fits in hand is actually ergonomically perfect for a person, human, basically if you have the right size. Most adults have a full size. I'm quite short, and I have short arms as well, so I prefer my fiddle here, which is 7/8 of a full size, and it's called a woman's full size. They were popular at the turn of the century, and often they were made in the past not actually on purpose, just depending on the violin master who made it and the size of the wood. So I'm shaking out my hand to show you just how natural the violin is. When you wish to play the fiddle, you basically relax your hand and lock it in the relaxed position and flip it upwards. That's exactly how the violin should fit in the hand. Likewise, classical players tend to hold their bow in a very, very, very strained position and use long strokes. Oh, yeah. For those who don't know, I guess I should go over the parts. I'm going to finish this piece first. With a fiddle, it's the same. You take your hand, shake it, lock it, drop the elbow. And that, other than the adjustment of bending the thumb, is how you hold the bow. Now, I'm going to go over the parts of the violin. This is your bow. A good bow is made with horsehair. It can be white or black. The black makes a much coarser sound. It's really good for rough fiddling like Breton or some of the Appalachian stuff where you're really droning. Now generally you shouldn't be touching the hair. I have, because I've cleaned my hands and I have a means of touching the bow. And comes apart. It's a good time sometimes to check. See, that's all horsehair. Sorry, I'm a bit I have a motor problem. I have developmental coordination disorder, so if I ever seem really clumsy or shaky, it's because I'm trying to think and talk at the same time, which I can't actually move automatically. I have to think about it, so dual tasking is a bit difficult. And I'll also talk about selecting your instrument before I go on. With a bow, bows can range from $25, which usually are carbon fiber or just plastic with nylon hair. That sounds really awful, even for a young person who's just learning. It's really not worth getting the nylon hair. You will get screeches and squeals and squeaks. And if I were to run my fingers across the bow with nylon, it would squeak even with the fingers. But a good bow in the mid-range, about $400 to $500, is often made of carbon fiber or a hardwood like oak or maple. My bow is Pernambuco, which is a bow made from a rainforest tree. And it's makes the best bows. However, if I were to purchase a bow now, unless it was old, like this bow here is a 50-year-old bow. I wouldn't purchase a Pernambuco bow because the trees are going extinct from overuse, and a lot of the wood for bows is poached on these trees. Now, it's not because they were overused that they're going extinct. It's because of the habitat loss, which is really, really, really unfortunate. The second best wood, snake wood, is also in the same kind of category. Rosewood or sandalwood was often used in the past, but it is not safe. Paint doesn't stay on a bow, and people often grind the wood underneath, depending on some of the techniques they're using. And sandalwood dust and rosewood dust is very, very irritating, carcinogenic, and has some toxic properties, so just avoid that now. You can find some old bows, but I don't recommend. Carbon fiber bows are very decent, and like I said, you can get a good one for a young person at a small size, about $28 to about $40. Good one at a full size in the $100 to $500, depending on the bow. This bow is about $2,000, which is not actually the highest. A lot of good bows are, like a good Pernambuco bow, will be up to $4,000, $8,000. So, yeah, I like my bow, but it's a classical violinist would probably have a better bow. So one of the things you want is you want to make sure your bow, when it's tightened right here, has a nice curve in it and should be able to bend. If there's no curve or it's curved outwards, then the bow is being damaged or not made properly, and it's just not worth playing. So, yeah, one thing you'll need is rosin. Types of rosin here. I have some light colored rosin and some base rosin. Until you really know what style you want to play, stay away from the base rosin. It's more expensive than this, even for semi-decent stuff, and it's really hard to play. I use it because I like the k-k-k sound. So when you first get rosin, where did my file go? I had a file here. maybe just start it off with the nail file. Just get some good scratches on it. And the bone may not be very well lozenged at first. So you use the rosin so that they provide more stickiness and crunchiness to the string so that it can actually produce the vibrations on the string. Imagine like 100 of little tiny spikes that all hit the bow as you go across, because horsehair has scales, just like your own human hair. You know, if you try to pull it backwards, you get that teeth look. And so you would start at the bottom and you just really want to cover the whole thing. There should be loads of rosin in there. You have enough. And you can see a dust cloud come off the bowl. And then you can put it's not taking a very unclear sound, like as you can see. But, so Fiddles Jack split back, and for all those of you who know some Celtic musicians, I have an orange ribbon on here, because orange is the color of the support research and the end of leukemia. One of my favorite violin teachers and musicians, just a brilliant, awesome human. Oliver Shore passed away many years ago, about 6, 7, maybe even longer, of leukemia, and all the fiddlers who ever took lessons from him have tied an orange ribbon on the end of their fiddle in memory and in respect of him. So parts of the violin are, like I said, this is your chin rest, and you can have a violin with no chin rest, you can have a violin with a chin rest. Right in the center, like this one. They're really easy to take on and off. You can't do it with your fingers, there's a little hole right there, and you just stick a pen or something pointing into that. And this one here, this is the tailpiece, and I have one detached right here. These things here are fine tuners. They hold the string and allow you to adjust it really, really slowly. As opposed to a band right under the violin. We have the screw. tuning pegs. These are for large adjustments and for changing strings. And I'm going to continue in a second video.